Smith, welcome to meeting number 12 of the 1991-92 council year, February 10th. Could I please have a roll call by the town clerk?
Chairman Creelman?
Here.
Counselor Amaral?
Here.
Counselor Codsall?
Here.
Counselor Chapel?
Here.
Counselor Jordan?
Yeah.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Here.
And Counselor Pearson?
Here. Would you please join me now in the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Next on the agenda this evening are the minutes of meeting number 11, held January 13th, 1992. What is your pleasure?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes,
Counselor. I move that we approve the minutes as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you very much. At this time in the agenda, we have a section entitled Citizens' Discussion of Items Not on the Agenda. Is there anyone here this evening in the audience that wishes to speak to a particular item? Seeing none, I will close that portion of the agenda. Next are reports and correspondence, of which I have a couple of things to report on myself. First is that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council honored one of our notable citizens, Richard Hughes, last Saturday night at the local Lincoln Club as a consequence of Dick's 31 years of service to Cape Elizabeth in a variety of capacities. As many of the viewers remember, Dick served Cape Elizabeth with distinction in Augusta, both in the Senate and in the House, as well as having been Speaker of the House for one term. And the list goes on and on from the point of view of Dick's dedication and giving to the community of Cape Elizabeth as well as the state of Maine. So we were delighted that we could honor him at that particular function. Secondly, I'd like to report relatively good news from the point of view of the final 1992 Cumberland County budget. The actual 92 upcoming budget for the county is actually down from last year. In the final analysis, it's down $36,000 roughly from last year, which is a negative 0.45% decrease. There was a negative decrease back in 84, but that was the last time we saw negative numbers with big jumps. 89 up 25%, 1990 up 34%. So we were certainly delighted that the commissioners could chip away at that budget to help us in our difficult budget session upcoming. And I should note that of the several municipalities in Cumberland County, Cape Elizabeth's assessment is actually down from last year. Some assessments were up. Cape Elizabeth is down $4,632. So based on our particular percentage, we again are delighted that that can help us be as frugal as possible when we go about our budgetary process over the next several months. Thirdly, I would like to at this point welcome the Chairman of the Conservation Commission to the podium at this time, since a great amount of thankfulness is in order for both the chairman and especially Jeanette Hagen, who has done a gorgeous project for the Conservation Commission that Chairman Roberts is going to tell us about right now.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the town council. It gives me great pleasure to be here this evening to present the town with a compilation of maps and material to the various land acquisitions and easements that the town has received primarily through the efforts of the Conservation Commission since 1979. The commission last spring decided that we needed to get together some of the information that we had. It was scattered about in a number of different places. And some of the town council, in fact, went with us on a site walks as we visited all the land holdings that the town has, either through our own, through the commission, or through the land trust. And from that, we discovered we had 13 parcels of land. We're currently working on 4 or 5 more, and this will be an ongoing project. The compilation that Jeanette Hagan put together includes maps, photos, and deeds of all the parcels of land. And the information that's provided on those includes the property name, type of interest, holder of interest, donor or the seller of the property, the date of transfer, location and description, restrictions, permissible activities, and comments. And there is also a monitoring form so that we can keep up to date on what's happening with these properties. The copy that I will be giving you this evening, I hope to have turned over to Maureen O'Meara in the planning department, as that would seem to be the best place to have it. And when she's working with developers, can show them some of the things that we've done with other parcels to let them know what our interests are in this area. There will be a copy to the Conservation Commission, and Jeanette has also provided a copy to Peter Rand and the Land Trust in thanks for the efforts that he did in giving her a lot of information. Jeanette put a lot of time into this. Actually had to dig through our files that Peter Rand holds most of those currently, and also going to the Registry of Deeds to ferret out some of the information that was not available, and then she proceeded to color the maps. The booklets or the folders that we have with all of the, everything is detailed in sections, nice plastic covers for everything, and Jeanette did this at her own expense, did not come out of our budget, and she is donating that as well as her time to the town. So with that, I will present this to you and say we're working for you.
Well, thank you very much, Chairman Roberts. Councilor Cogsall and myself and the town manager had an opportunity to already review these documents at our quarterly meeting that we hold for the chairman and chairwomen of the land use committees in Cape Elizabeth, and it's really just a sterling piece of work. Hours and hours have gone into this as a documentary of the parcels that that are available, and we are very, very thankful to both yourself and certainly to Jeanette Hagan, who was not able to be with us tonight, for this wonderful piece of work that we are very indebted. Thank you very much, Jack.
Thank you.
Fourth, I would like to publicly let citizens know that we will be having 2 open houses coming up on February 27th from 4 to 6 p.m. This will be an opportunity to look at the new addition to the Public Works facility, as well as an opportunity for citizens to visit 1226 Shore Road. So I believe that's a Thursday afternoon that all of you are welcome to come by for some very light refreshments and have an opportunity to look at both of these facilities that we're quite proud of this year. And then lastly on my agenda is just to share a letter that both the town manager and I received from Senator George Mitchell, thanking us for our attendance at a December 21st meeting regarding the implementation of the Safe Drinking Water Act. In response to the concerns that we raised at that meeting, both Senator Mitchell and Congressman Andrews intervened in our behalf and sent a letter to the administrator of the Environmental Protection Agency, Mr. Riley, asking him a variety of questions for which we hope we can get reasonable answers in the very near future as a consequence of this extraordinary expense to improve the already excellent water from Sebago Lake. So again, we're very thankful for both Congressman Andrews as well as Senator Mitchell's intervening in our behalf. That completes my materials. Other reports and correspondence. I see Councilor Amaral, please.
Yes, a couple of items. The first one, just last week it was announced by the National League of Cities that our town council chair, Dr. Wayne Creelman, will serve as vice chairman of the National League of Cities Human Development Policy Committee. This is one of the five standing policy committees that the National League of Cities operates in order to develop policy statements on various issues. This particular committee is going to have 35 dignitaries from across the country serving on it. And the major issue that they're going to be looking at is healthcare. And I'm sure that Dr. Creelman, with his background, is going to bring a lot of knowledge and expertise to that committee. And we're really proud here in Cape Elizabeth that he's been chosen for that leadership role at the national level. Also, I wanted to mention the fact that our town manager is serving on, I think, another very important committee, and one in which the state has a great deal of interest, and that is how we're going to resolve our problems with workman's compensation. And I think this group of people representing labor management, the public private sector, and the fact that what they're doing is looking at other states' experience and where other states have been able to provide services at much lower costs than we are. So I think that's a great contribution to the state as well. And one last item I had is that I can't help but mention that our counselor down here at the end of to my right never missed a meeting, even though he was out out of circulation, I guess you could say, while he had major surgery this past month. And we're really pleased to have you back, Bill, and to see that you made that great commitment to be with us tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jane. Other reports, I see Councilor Jordan, please.
See, Councilor Namo brought that up. I'll take this opportunity to thank all the people that sent me cards, gave me telephone calls, and wished me the best. And I'm working on getting my voice back. It never was very loud in some ways. Some people thought it was loud, but it never went out loud. But it was weaker than it is now, and it's improving every day, and I thank you all.
It's good to have you back, Billy. Your voice has never been a problem expressing your sentiment to anyone here. Other reports? Council McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just want to report to the council that I did was able to attend part of the COG Executive Committee meeting in January, on January 15th. I believe Bob Malley, our Public Works Director, was there for the afternoon session, at which time the
Commissioner.
Thank you. they had a presentation from the Commissioner of Transportation, the Executive Committee, in the evening, heard from one of the Deputy Commissioners, and had conversations about the referendum that was passed in November. The local COG in Portland and the Southern Maine COG are working together to establish the Southern Maine Economic Development District, and seem to be making some very good headway with that. That's going to help facilitate public entities in their access to federal dollars and eventually may be of some economic value to this community. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Councilor Coxley.
Yes, last Tuesday, Councilor McLaughlin, Mr. McGovern, our town planner Maureen O'Meara, and I attended the Maine Municipal Association's annual meeting with our state legislators. It was an all-day session in Augusta with various workshops and sort of a coming together of group consensus. I think those representatives and state senators who were there got a very clear, strong message from the municipalities about our financial difficulties and how we expect them to solve their own and not impose them upon us.
Well, thank you very much for representing us there. It's a very, very important. This was the third annual meeting, I guess.
I believe so.
Great. And our town clerk, I think, has a couple of announcements.
Thank you. Just a couple. Both the Democratic and Republican town committees have set the date for their caucus. They both will be held on Sunday, February 23rd. The Republican caucus will be held right here in the council chambers at 12 noon. The Democratic caucus will be held at the high school cafeteria at 3 p.m. Those of you that are looking forward to the municipal election, a couple of dates to remember. Nomination papers are available Thursday, February 20th. Nomination papers are due Tuesday, March 31st. Anyone that is interested, please contact me. We have 2 seats available on the town council and 2 seats available on the school board. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other items for this part of the agenda? Councilor Cogswell.
I forgot to mention that Councilor Amaro also attended that meeting in Augusta last week. Sorry,
part
Jane.
Part of it.
You were there.
Very good. Let us move then to the first and only public hearing this evening on the General Assistance Ordinance. This is item 119, and it is to consider a proposed General Assistance Ordinance and take any necessary action. I will defer to Mr. McGovern.
General assistance is the program of local assistance to persons who are in need. Every so often, the state legislature revises the statutes governing general assistance, and then they require the local communities to come into compliance with their regulations. The Maine Municipal Association did provide the community a model general assistance ordinance, I could go over it in extensive detail. There are approximately 30 changes that have been made. If anyone from the public would like me to review it, I'd be happy to, or from the council, all the various changes. Essentially, it does make need review, the unmet need, more difficult than it has been in the past.
Thank you. At this time, I will open the public hearing to any of the public here this evening to speak on the General Assistance Ordinance. Seeing none, I will close the public portion of the meeting and entertain a motion at this time.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Councilor.
I would move that we adopt the General Assistance Ordinance as presented to us.
I'll second.
There's a motion and a second. I see some discussion. Councilor.
Just a question or statement, I suppose, to the manager. I've been aware of one MMA-sponsored workshop session on this, and I don't know if Barbara Ray was able to go to that or not, but I would hope that when it's appropriate that we enable her to attend these, especially with the changes that keep coming down.
Very fine. Well, we do have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? The vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. That concludes the public hearings this evening. We'll proceed now to the rest of the agenda. Item number 120 this evening is to consider a report from the Appointments Committee on proposed 1992 appointments and take any necessary action. I will ask our Chairman of the Appointments Committee, Councilor Pearson, to report in.
Thank you, Chairman Creelman. Once again, the Appointments Committee was thrilled to have a response, which is typical of Cape Elizabeth, where we're fortunate to have more applicants than there are positions available, which is also unfortunate because we're not able to place some very qualified, motivated, interesting citizens that are willing to give of themselves to enhance Cape's community spirit. And I think that's very important, something that Cape Elizabeth is very proud to have. I'd like to read the recommendations, if I could, to the council. For Area Development Council, Joseph Calise. For the Planning Board, a reappointment of Stephen Parkhurst. Planning Board Associate, reappointment Tim Eichenberg. Planning Board Associate, reappointment Judy Lardner. Zoning Board, Judy Dooley, that's for a full term. Another full term, Wyatt Garfield on the Zoning Board. Zoning Board Associate, Robert Perner. Zoning Board Associate number 2, Linda Jacobs. On the Board of Health, we'd like to reappoint Dr. Robert Hillman. And also on the Board of Health, Linda Monroe. The Board of Assessment Review, I'd like to appoint John Ridge. Conservation Commission, Natalie Burns. Riverside Cemetery Trustees, Edward Macomb. And on Thomas Memorial Library Trustees, reappoint Marianne Lynch. And we'd like to appoint Michael Crowley also to the Thomas Memorial Library Trustees. For cable TV, we would like to appoint to a, reappoint, excuse me, Mr. Lee Chase. And we also have three more appointments for cable TV. Harry Proudman, we'd like to complete the unexpired term, which one of its members decided to go to the zoning board. And also on cable TV, Howard Krantman and Alistair McVicker. On the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, we'd like to reappoint Carolyn Smith, and we'd also like to recommend that Paul Thielen be on the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. Board of Historic Preservation, we'd like to reappoint Nancy Harvey, recommend Ann Foden, and recommend Douglas Gillies, also the Board of Historic Preservation. On the Arts Commission, we would like to recommend Rachel Perry for reappointment, and Susan Brazil and Verna Andrews to take two positions on the Arts Commission. On the Board of Harbor Commissioners, we'd recommend reappointment of Philip Perino, and the Board of Sewer Appeals, reappointment of John Perry and the reappointment of Scott Clark. The Personnel Appeals Board, we'd like to recommend for reappointment Gordon Davis. And then on our newest committee, the Recycling Committee, we'd like to recommend reappointment of Brigitte Kingsbury and Al Ripa. That is our recommendations to the council. And I'd also like to thank Irv and Jane for their help in putting up with me. And once again, thank everyone that applied and was interested in the positions that we had available. Once again, it helps maintain Cape Elizabeth as a beautiful place and a special place to call home. And I thank everyone that showed an interest. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Councillor Pearson. I don't know anyone in the audience that are on the list here other than our cameraman, for whom the citizens can't see.
No, we have one other, Ann Foden in the back.
There she is. Okay. Congratulations to both of you and to all of the others that will continue to serve our community with distinction. At this point, we will have to officially place them on the board, so I will entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I would move acceptance of the appointments committee's report with pleasure.
I'll second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Councillor McLaughlin.
I want to thank the appointments committee for the work that they put into this. I know the number of hours that goes into this and some of the hard decisions you have to make. I also very much appreciate the format that you presented it with, the comments in the sidebar. That's helpful to me, not knowing some of these people personally. And I hope that one comment on here will stick in the minds of people who may apply in the future. And I know one of these gentlemen applied for a library trustee position when I was on the appointments committee a number of years ago. He did persevere. He served us in a number of different positions, and as it says on here, he finally got where he wanted to be. And hope other people will understand. If you hang in there long enough, we try to work it out for you. So I appreciate the fact that we were able to do that for him this year.
Councillor Jordan.
I would just like to say I like the format that has come out here and the little comments that are beyond here of the appointees, and the one that interested me most was the ones for the Board of Sewer Appeals. They're ready to go to work as I read this and work the ordinance over, so maybe we can find them something to do and get them to work very soon.
Councillor Amaral.
Just one more comment. I have to commend Carl because he did do a great job as chair of our committee. The only problem he had was he could not keep us on schedule. That seems to be a problem that every chair of appointments committees have, because I know, Janet, you thank us for our time that we put in, but I'll tell you, it's really one of the most fun things that we do on the town council. We got to meet some really neat people. It's great.
Jim, we got finally done. We were scheduled for 9:15 on Tuesday night. We said, that's good, we can get home. And we didn't quite make it. It was near 10:30. But it's a great committee, and as long as my fellow councilors will allow me, and as long as I'm lucky enough to be on this council, that's the job I want. You never see anything like meeting these people and talking with them. My gosh, it makes you get up the next morning and say, life is wonderful. They are a great bunch. So just think of 31 appointments, and we had 37, I think, applicants, and six we couldn't use. They know why, and they're waiting for next year. I think it's just great, wonderful.
Well, we continue to keep outdoing ourselves with the caliber of people who are on these boards. It's amazing. Well, we do have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor of these appointments? 7-0 unanimous vote. Thank you very much. At this time, we move to item number 121, and this is to consider a report from the Director of Public Works on the completion of the Public Works Improvement Project and take any necessary action. I would ask our Director of Public Works to come to the podium, Mr. Malley. Good evening.
Mike, do you want to say any opening comments at all? Or?
I don't want to take your words out of your mouth.
You want to take my speech apart? Well, I am happy to say that we are complete. The project basically started a year from this month with the planning and approval process, and it's been a long process as a whole. It took a little bit longer, I think, than we originally thought, but the end result was that we have a nice addition to the garage itself, and we've made some improvements to the existing garage, and so we have a very nice place to come to work now. But there's just a few minor things that really need to be done. The masonry on the outside of the addition has to be washed, and there's some miscellaneous punch list items, just minor corrections to the walls and flooring and things like that that have to be taken care of. But the project is basically 99% complete as we are here tonight. In the memo that was put together, there were about 20 things that we felt we made improvements to, and rather than go through every one of them, I've kind of broken them down to three major areas. Number one is we really corrected numerous code and structural deficiencies to the garage itself. There were masonry repairs that were made to the building. Weather stripping was put around the large bay doors. There was a ventilation system installed in the garage, an oil and water separator that brought us into code compliance with the DEP for our floor drain. So there were a number of things that were taken care of that were pending out there. And not only was the addition work done, but again, to the existing facility, some work was done too, and which really made a big difference for us. We provided designated public and employee space in both the garage and the addition. The problem, again, with the garage before was that you never knew which door to come into to get a permit or ask a question, and now there's a designated public entrance. And people are still going around the building out of force of habit looking for the back door, but I think in time that they'll get the hang of it. But it's really made a big difference with the public coming in. They're no longer walking through the garage and trying to work around a mechanic to find me or find the clerk. And the entrance has really made a big difference. And I guess the third facet of the project is we've made much needed improvements to the site. And there are different opinions on how you like Jordan Way and the new roadway alignment, but it has made a big difference with us keeping private vehicles off the site. It's a lot easier now to come in with the trucks and turn around and not know if you're going to find a car in the way or meet something head on. And I think talking with the school people that roadway realignment for them is working out well also. They have no problems with it. I've talked with Rick DeFusco and things are working out, from what I hear, very well on their end. Baseball season is just around the corner, and I guess we'll see how it'll work then. But I think it's going to work out well in the long run. And I think by closing the road off in June, it made a big difference. At the start of school, there didn't seem to be the confusion that we thought there would be. And there's still probably one or two cars a week, you know, that do come in and turn around. But it's worked out very well, and we've had a lot of positive comments about it. We recently had an open house and tour for a senior citizens group last Thursday, and they spoke very highly of the project as a whole and had a lot of good comments about it, and we're very positive as a group about the work that was done there. One area outlined in the memo that we thought if we could change, we would like to, is the curb cut. that is near the Gas Pump Islands. The intent of that curb cut initially was to provide access for the buses to fuel up, for us to get back and forth to the schoolyards for snow plowing purposes. And I guess the idea, we had good intentions with it, but I think what's going to happen is if we open that up permanently, we're going to have traffic flowing in and then down to the high school. So right now we've got it blocked off with snow and barricades, but I think we're going to have to revisit that in time as to, you know, whether we think that's a good idea to keep that open. Because right now there's cars coming in and they have to turn around, but I think if we open that up, that over time it's going to be an easy route to the high school and we're going to be back to the same problem that we had before. So I think that, you know, we will have to revisit that in the future, and I'm not sure if we have to go back to the planning board or not, but.
I spoke to the town planner on that, and she didn't feel that it was a substantive change. So, you know, unless the council objected, you know, we'd probably look toward closing that off. The fear is it could be real dangerous with vehicles moving quickly around the corner of the garage to scoot into the high school or in the other direction, and it's not something we want to encourage. It, as you look at it from the high school looking up, it looks so easy as a place to go through. So we're very concerned about opening it.
I think what I'd like to see is a small opening so we can get mowers through, you know, to the ball fields, but then a continuation of the sidewalk and esplanade and maybe a couple of more trees so it blends into the existing esplanade that's there right now. But we do need an opening to get back and forth to the athletic fields with our equipment, so it would be small enough, it would say 6 feet wide, but not wide enough for a car to go through. I guess lastly, I'd like to thank a lot of the people that were involved in the project as a whole. Firstly, you folks that approved the project, and I know we went through a lot of meetings and deliberations on it, but it was your vote that ultimately, you know, approved the project, and I wish to thank you personally for it, and also Rosemary Reed, who is now on the school board, but who was very vocal and very supportive of the project from day one. So, you know, I would like to mention her. I'd like to thank Irv and his fellow members of the Facilities Committee. They were, I think, an excellent mix of people to work with. We had citizens that worked in town, we had professional people, and I thought it was a good makeup of people that had a lot of good ideas on it. And I want to thank Irv, and, you know, for his help and his guidance through the project. Irv came over and checked up on us on a weekly basis. Kept an eye on things, so. But it was a good committee to work with. I had a lot of fun with them, and you know, they can be proud of their accomplishments. And I'd like to thank my department personnel for putting up with a lot of aggravation during the process. There were times when they'd come in and the tables where they ate lunch were covered with dirt and dust, and sometimes there was no heat, and they put up with a lot through the process. And the end result now is that they have a great facility, but there was a few touching times, you know, during the summer months. But I want to thank them. And also the citizens that pledged their support. At our initial open house, we didn't have many people come in, but what few people did were very supportive and felt that once they came through the garage and looked around, that there was no question that something needed to be done. And we're still getting a lot of good comments about the facility and how well it's working out for us. So I want to thank them. Does anybody have any questions at all? Or I'd like to have you stop by and see us sometime if you're out and about. So. And again, to remind people about the open house on February 27th.
Any questions at all for Mr. Mallon? Well, maybe before the motion, let me just have you stand there for a moment, because we also have a particular thanks. This is a plaque from the town council in appreciation to Robert Malley for all your efforts leading to the successful completion of the 1991-1992 Public Works Garage improvements. Thank you very much, Bob.
Thank
you did a wonderful job.
No surprise.
Well, at this point, I will take a motion for acceptance of Mr. Malley's report.
So moved.
Second.
One question.
Yes, please, Councilor Jordan.
I have a question that I got a grin when I say it, but anyway. I thought Councilor Hammer and I had quite a time when we put this budget together, ending up with $400,000. Now, where did the $18,000 come from? It went over.
No, it was.
It says here $418,000.
No, it was $400,000 plus $18,000 that had been set aside earlier for the oil tank. The replacement of the oil tank replacement in the previous year's budget. I will get out the memo. Before this memo was prepared, I looked back just to make sure I didn't fall into any traps, and it was in fact $418,000, but it was $400,000 for the project and $18,000 in the previous year's budget for the replacement of the underground heating oil tank, for a total of $418,000.
Well, the way this reads, the improvements at the public works garage on budget at $418,000.
Yeah, we carried forward the $18,000 from the previous year.
Oh, thank you.
Bill, you can't vote to accept something and then fuss about
$18,000. $18,000 out of $400,000 is, in my book, quite a lot of money. I think I should be able to comment it with a smile.
Councilor Amaral.
I think, if my memory is right, too, Councilor Jordan, that the manager assured us it would come in at under $400,000. However, I think that's what he said.
Right.
I think we're still right on target.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you. Now that we know that Councilor Jordan is back in full fettle.
Yeah.
Bob Malley mentioned the possibility of closing off that opening, and I think I hear what he's saying about the need to have some kind of opening there for the smaller maintenance vehicles to get to the fields. I think it's fine to close that off to the extent possible. You know, you're saying something 6 feet wide that a car can't go through there. A number of drivers would disagree with that, trying to get down to the high school. But I would hope that we can find a good solution in closing that off to the extent possible so we aren't going to encounter the traffic that would be a potential hazard there.
Councilor Jordan.
I think they got a big gate there that would get that through with no one beside it. Just open the gate.
That's a possibility.
Well, we do have that motion, and we have a second. If there is no further discussion, all those in favor of accepting the report, it is a 7-0 vote. Again, Bob, thank you very, very much. And just to dispel one rumor, there's this rumor going around Cape Elizabeth that the sign over the front door has cost thousands and thousands of dollars. In reality, it was under $200. Isn't that correct, just to dispel these kind of myths that can get well out of hand very, very quickly? Please, please, Mr. Malley, come right back again.
No, there was a lot of rumors flying around about the sign above the doorway, and the truth was that it's actually cast concrete, and it is a lintel for the doorway. Every doorway has to have a lintel, so we thought that we'd kill two birds with one stone and put the sign in the lintel. And the letters were styrofoam letters that were put into the mold of the concrete. And just the process, I think, cost about $150,000, but there were figures flying around in the thousands of dollars, and that it was carved by Egyptian stone cutters. it just wasn't the truth at all. So it was a very economical way of signage on the building, and very permanent, too.
And it looks excellent.
Yep, good. Thank you.
Is that a header or a lintel?
Thank you very much. Let us proceed now to item 122, and this is to consider, or at least to begin the process of considering a request from Mr. Coleman Gorham to have the town review its ordinance relating to the conversion of single-family residences to multi-unit dwellings and take any necessary action. At this time, I would ask Mr. Gorham to address the council from the podium, please. I certainly will. Thank you.
Members of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, my purpose in addressing you again tonight is to talk about the Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance, and specifically that part of the ordinance having to do with section 19-4-7B and D, which is entitled conditional use conversion to multi-unit dwelling. I would like to pick up where I left off at last month's meeting. Among the topics I discussed three conditional use applications in my neighborhood. In addition, I read from the zoning board hearing transcripts concerning the conversion to multi-unit ordinance. At the zoning board hearing in October 89, the chairman stated, quote, "I think that if I lived, and I do live in a single-family unit, I wouldn't want to have a multi-unit dwelling up around me," end of quote. Later in the hearing, the zoning board chairman stated, quote, "The direction of this town has always been single-family dwellings, and maybe the council made a mistake in allowing the multi-unit dwellings. It shouldn't have allowed any in this town." I find this comment incredible. And the compelling question is, why didn't the zoning board chairman ask the town council members at the time of his appointment to the board if they indeed made a mistake as he suggested? And another question that needs to be asked is, why didn't the zoning board chairman at that time in the hearing move that the application be tabled until the zoning board could go back to the town council and ask for an interpretation of the conversion ordinance? The zoning board had in previous instances postponed a decision until they got a ruling from the town attorney. Another board member stated, quote, "And so I probably, knowing, again my own personal opinion, if someone had put a multi-unit next to mine, I think it would probably adversely affect my property value." The zoning board chairman went on to say, quote, "And yet we're faced with an ordinance that says we're supposed to permit it if certain conditions are met. I mean, I happen to agree with you that if I were drafting the ordinance, I wouldn't want to see a lot of multi-unit dwellings, but that's not my job here tonight, and I'm having real problems figuring out why, if the conditions are met, we shouldn't allow it," end of quote. Now here you have board members announcing publicly that they disagree with the ordinance. And of course, they all vote to deny my application. Again, I find this incredible. At this point in the hearing, the board members figure they can deny the application on the basis of adverse effect, but they need to tighten their argument. They need to find a place or circumstance in which a conversion would not cause adverse effect. And after racking their brains, one board member came up with what he thought was a situation where a conversion would not adversely affect adjacent property. And this is what he said, quote,
"Mr. Gorham, with all due respect, I'm reviewing here your comments this evening with the 12-page series of comments that you offered us during our last meeting. They seem to be substantially the same, and my concern is we're going over the same material twice. What we're prepared to do at this point is to begin the process of reviewing our ordinance based on your input. Do you think you could just address your pertinent comments to what you want us to do rather than review the history of the issue?"
Well, all right, I will give you my prepared statement. Basically, my position is that the conditional use ordinance should not have been connected with the conversion to multi-unit. And I think in the history of the ordinance development, there is an overlapping. A number of them, there are actually three standards in each of those ordinances that overlap. And I think that they should be severed because the conditional use standards call for stricter standards because you're dealing with major impacts on adjacent residential property. While with a conversion to an accessory apartment, you have a very minor impact. And what creates the problem is I believe it's the fourth standard in the conditional use ordinance, which says that conversion will not adversely impact on adjacent property. And with that particular standard, that makes it really impossible to get approval for a conversion. And also, Standard 1 and Standard 3 of the multi-unit dwelling conversion ordinance, the first standard calls for 2,500 square feet for a house to be converted. Now, in my case, I have much more than that, so that is not an issue with me. I've been studying the ordinances of seven or eight towns in the general area of Cape Elizabeth. I find that 2,500 feet is the far in excess of the others. In fact, Falmouth, which has one of the largest, is 1,500 square feet. Another standard, Standard 3, calls for 900 square feet for the accessory apartment. And last month, they gave you a floor plan of an apartment that had two full bedrooms, two baths, a living room, dining room, kitchen, closet space that was much less than 900 square feet. So that the 900 square feet and the 2,500 square feet will eliminate something like 96% of the houses in Cape Elizabeth. And I've given you material showing you about eight different floor plans of houses that have less than 2,500 square feet, and none of those could qualify for a conversion in Cape Elizabeth. So that is the thrust of my position, that the two ordinances should be separated because the conditional use have to do with multiplex dwellings, they have to do with motels, hotels, they have to do with schools, et cetera, et cetera. And with the conversion to multi-unit, and in fact, I've asked that that term be changed because that's kind of misleading, because originally one could convert to two or three units, and that was changed in 1987 to only an additional unit, a total of two. So multi-unit dwelling conjures up an apartment house, and that really sets people off with irrational fears about it. When my mouth is really dry. So again, I feel that those two ordinances should be separated, and that the 2,500 square feet should be maybe lowered to say 2,000, which is still 500 more than Falmouth, and down to 600, which is more than Falmouth. I don't need those changed my own personal, because I've met those particular standards. And the standard that really, you know, knocked me out of the ballpark was the adverse effect. And other towns will, if they do have that particular standard of adverse effect, they'll put in the term or the adjective significant, because somebody, you know, that objects can just say, well, you know, it adversely affects, and everybody's an expert. And they say that a neighbor is an expert just as well as a certified appraiser. And in my case, I had two certified appraisers that said that my conversion would not adversely affect the adjacent property. And at the same time, the Inn by the Sea, which was a conditional use and it was abutting a residential property with six cottage units and with 41 parking units, plus opening the restaurant to the public, plus a underground septic system, that was deemed not adversely affecting, and they got approval. So there's no, you know, balance there at all. I mean, and the same appraiser that appraised the Inn by the Sea appraised my situation, and in both cases they said it wouldn't adversely affect. The NYSE gets approval, I get disapproval on the basis of this adverse effect standard, which I think really has to be dealt with. And if it has to be included, then you have to use the word a significant adverse effect. But I really think that in July 29th of 87, when the town council drew up the new seven standards for conversion to multi-unit, they drew up a very good set of standards that was going to protect adverse effect. And many of those standards have to do with the appearance and the architecture to protect the impact on abutting property. And I really think that that this needs to be dealt with otherwise, and the statistics. Since 1987, July 29th, 87, when the ordinance was amended, there is only one approval, and that approval is very suspect because it was disapproved on two previous occasions, two different applications, and without nothing materially changing in the meanwhile. So that, and also the five previous ones from 1985 to 87, there were five that were approved. If they were to meet the same standards currently, they wouldn't be able to meet them. So we have two sets of ordinances here, the conditional use and the conversion to multi-unit, that is just blocking any conversion, and that is against the objectives of the council and its objective of the committee that grew up for affordable housing, and it just seems that that we have two ordinances that are just frustrating and blocking any kind of a conversion. And I think that after reading my materials and the I think that you will see the problem, and I really feel that you will do something about it to correct it. I appreciate your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Gorham. So that the issue here would be to begin the process of reviewing this particular ordinance, and the motion this evening would be, as recommended, to refer the request to the Planning Board. Are there questions for Mr. Gorham from the council members at this time? Councilor McLaughlin.
Mr. Gorham, have you initiated a formal text amendment through the Planning Department?
In the materials, yes, I have made suggestions, and let's see if I can find them here.
I see the suggestions in the material that has been handed to me this evening. My question to you is, have you gone to the Planning Department with this proposal?
Have I gone?
To the Planning Department.
Planning Department?
The town's Planning Department, the town planner.
Well, I just thought that the ordinance would originate here. I didn't.
Okay, I don't know if you were advised to come to the council with this, or you've done that under your own initiative. My concern.
Yes, I thought this is where I would to, you know, take my suggestion. I didn't know that it was the role of the Planning Board, you know, to draw up the ordinances. I thought it was the Town Council that formulated the ordinances and enacted them.
You're half right, anyway, I would say. I'm concerned that I'm hearing desire for a motion for the town, what sounds to me like the town, to initiate this text amendment, and I'm not sure that's the way I want to move at this moment anyway. We very recently have done a lot of work and have initiated and adopted a new affordable housing ordinance. Hindsight is always great. I wish we had the benefit of your input before that was on our agenda. That was publicized, however, we did have a public hearing on it. There were allusions to that last month when you had a couple of supporters here with you from various churches throughout the community. We do have a procedure for, outlined in the ordinance, for text amendments and zoning map changes, and I'm just wondering, you know, you've kind of answered my question why you're here before us. Your understanding was that it was the council who went forward with that rather than an individual. But just so you'll know, and people listening tonight will know, that individuals very often come forward with text amendments to the zoning ordinance. A recent one that I'm aware of would be Tom Tinsman with the text amendment procedure he went through. I also don't know what kind of time frame you're looking for to have this matter addressed, and if you're looking for it in the to be done on a fast track, I would hope that you or whoever is interested would be a bit more realistic. I'm not sure this is going to happen on a real fast track, as I said, especially since we've just done the affordable housing ordinance. I'm not saying I don't want to look at this, but I'm very concerned that we set a precedent here that we get caught in later. And I'm saying this as much for the rest of the council as I am for your edification about that. So that's why I asked my initial question, if you had initiated this through the planning department.
No, I wasn't aware of the procedure. I didn't want to be so presumptuous as to actually draw up a formal ordinance. I could do that. But in response to affordable housing, I commend the council for drawing up that ordinance. But one has to keep in mind that because of the economy being depressed and so on, not many developers are going to be building affordable housing. However, with conversion to accessory apartments, this is something that can be expedited much quicker because, and there aren't many. I mean, the few that can qualify, it is rather a minor chore to make the conversion, and but again, I apologize. It was my understanding. I'm naive. I just thought that the town council was the one that drew up the ordinances and enacted them, and so I just went full headed ahead and proceeded.
Other questions or clarifications for Mr. Gorham? Councilor Amwell.
Well, I think that I know that the town council has on many occasions decided that it was time to review an ordinance, to look at pieces of an ordinance, and I guess I don't have any problem with a citizen coming forward and suggesting that we review an ordinance. And I guess I'm not having the same difficulty with this as Janet is. I mean, what I'm saying is I don't know why we can't just refer this to the planning board if it's something that we think needs to be addressed.
Please, Councilor McLaughlin, did you want to respond?
Respond to Councilor Amaro. If we do get to the point where we're referring this to a board, I think it might be advisable to refer it to the zoning board rather than the planning board. The planning board is not the entity that has to come up with ordinance language, and if this is something that the zoning board deals with rather than the planning board, it might be more appropriate for the zoning board to look at the language since they would presumably be more familiar with it. I also say that based on a conversation today with the town planner explaining what the workload is at the planning board level right now. I did not check with the code enforcement officer to see what the zoning board workload looked like, but that was a comment that has been made to me.
That the planning board workload was heavy?
That they're
really
deeply
because
immersed.
The people we just interviewed for that position said it had been very, very light.
Reference was made to the street reclassification procedure that we're going through right now.
They're doing a lot of planning, mm-hmm. and not just site plan
not reviews.
Yeah. May I make a comment? In the comprehensive plan and also in the Committee for Affordable Housing, both of them recommended that an ordinance for conversion to accessory apartment put on the books, and that goes back 3 years for the Committee on Affordable Housing, and the comprehensive plan recommendation is over 2 years. So, I mean, you know, time is important, and...
I'm going to have the town manager help a little bit here, hopefully. Section 19-4-9 involves amendments, and section paragraph 3 here. Mr. McGovern, could you perhaps help us all with respect to your interpretation of the appropriate procedure?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yeah, the reason I suggested that this might want to be referred to the planning board is because of section 3 of the amendment procedure for the zoning ordinance. What that reads, before public hearing by the town council, any proposed amendment or change, unless initiated by the planning board, shall be submitted to the planning board for public hearing and recommendations to the town council, and then it goes on with notice, et cetera. That's why I suggested that this be referred to the planning board, because it's in keeping with the amendment procedure as contained in the zoning ordinance. Above that, there was also a question when I looked at this and was preparing the agenda, on whether or not Mr. Gorham should have paid a $100 fee that comes in when you request a change in the zoning ordinance. What that section reads is, our request for amendment to the text of the zoning ordinance, so for changes in zone boundary lines or other proposals to change the zoning map initiated by other than the planning board of the town council, shall be accompanied by a fee in the amount of $100. No such request or proposal should be referred to the planning board for public hearing unless and until said fee is paid. I did not specifically ask Mr. Gorham for $100 prior to this, because he had sent in a letter to the council chairman subsequent to the last meeting, simply asking for this item to be placed on the agenda. You know, he didn't indicate that he was coming forward with a specific text change, and that's why I didn't hold him up for $100.
Does that help from the point of view of the possibility of the motion this evening that could or could not be passed? Yes, Councilor McLaughlin.
Mr. McGovern, are you saying that this should go to the council would be better served to refer this to the planning board rather than the zoning board?
In keeping with Section 3 of the zoning amendment procedure, yes, that is what I'm saying.
I interpret it differently then. Shall be submitted to the planning board for a public hearing. I don't see there that the planning board is the entity that does the language.
Yeah, for public hearing and recommendations to the town council.
Text change.
It's, as long as I've been here, it's always been the process before the zoning ordinance is amended, the planning board needs to review it, and the planning board needs to hold a public hearing.
Could the zoning board develop what the planning board is to review and have a public hearing on?
I would think that, you know, this was discussed at the meeting of the land use chairs, and my understanding was that the planning board would, if this was referred to them, would work very closely with the zoning board in developing a proposal.
Okay, I wasn't.
But technically, the ordinance procedure indicates that at some point the planning board needs to have this. And
yeah, I'm not arguing that fact at all.
It needs to be initiated by them. It needs to be referred to them. So by, you know, referring it to them, you take care of that point in the...
I'm not at all arguing the fact that the planning board have a public hearing on it. Of course, we've had our problems with that in the past, too, with the planning board public hearing. I don't want to get into that conundrum this evening. But I really think I really want to be sure that the zoning board has input into something like this, because I'm very concerned about them being the board that works with that part of the ordinance. I think they're the ones with the expertise, not the planning board. And maybe Councilor Coggeshall, having been on zoning board, can speak to that.
You beat me to it, but anyway.
Please.
Are you through?
Yes, for the time being.
Please,
Mr. Chairman, I think this process is very long and lengthy, and it's far more complicated than it's being presented, because I think before we can refer this ordinance to any board, we as a town council have to decide on the policy. If we want the ability of certain people, homeowners, to convert accessory apartments, if so, how extensively. I think we need to decide that as a board. And then I think that that it can be referred to the planning board with the assistance and direction of the Zoning Board of Appeals, because this is a very talented group of people. Their basic responsibility is interpreting ordinances, and it also is a very good learning process to be involved in drafting, so you know the intent. All recommendations, understandably, would have to go to the planning board, and they would review it, make any changes, and have their public hearing and refer it back to us. But I don't think it's as simple as just referring it to the planning board, which right now is working very hard planning and on some other ordinance changes. The zoning board has not had a meeting for over 2 months because they haven't had any appeals before them. And if you want to maintain interest and skill in a board, you've got to have them doing something, and this is a good learning process to help drafting. So I would move that we as a town council at some point perhaps have a workshop on this, that if we decide that we want it to be addressed, to refer it to the planning board, and also give direction to the Zoning Board of Appeals to draft a similar ordinance. And it goes beyond just the conversion. It goes with dealing with conditional use, which has always been a very vague and oftentimes a can of worms in the ordinance, and perhaps in itself should be looked at as an separate issue.
Councilor, may I take that comment as a motion?
Yes. I think it's a little longer than it should be. Let's have the motion as far as conditional use considerations, separate issue.
May I make a comment?
We have to see if the secretary.
You're referring this to workshop.
Town council workshop.
Town council workshop. And then possibly on to the planning board, giving direction to the zoning board for a draft ordinance.
Yes. Which they will submit to the planning board.
This includes conditional use as a separate issue?
No, these conditional use as a separate issue could be considered at another time. Right now, it would just be the accessory apartments.
Okay, is everyone clear about that motion?
I'll second the motion.
Okay, there is a motion and a second. Councilor Jordan.
Excuse me, it appears to me to be a long route that we have to go, but if we could get a workshop along between now and our next meeting, then we could refer it on to the planning and the zoning board, is that correct? I think this ought to be moved forward because I think there's homes and other homes in Cape Elizabeth that are too large for a couple, and there's a way they could have a conversion. I think it should be done very much in favor of the movement, and I'd just like to be able to move it along.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Amaral.
I agree with Councilor Jordan. I think that our comprehensive plan, which incorporates the recommendations of the Affordable Housing Commission, sets policy. We have really, by accepting that comprehensive plan, agreed to a policy of not only permitting, but in some instances allowing for the encouragement of accessory type apartments as one way of addressing the affordable housing issue. So I feel that we have town policy on it already. And when we do find an ordinance that may be in conflict with that comprehensive plan, I think we ought to review it and try to do it as in the most efficient way we can without drawing the process out. So I guess basically I don't see a real need for a workshop for this to get started. But maybe, Phyllis, you can tell me more
I
as
guess
to why you think
since
you
we accepted the adoption, we adopted the comprehensive plan. Mm-hmm. And then there were various steps that we'd have to take to implement it.
Right.
and I see this workshop as one of the implementation steps. When we have accessory apartments, are we talking just one apartment in a single-family resident? We didn't really deal with that.
Okay. Thank you.
I would just like to say, does the manager have somebody that to do some research on this and set it up with the procedure that we should go and see what has been done according to what Councilor Amaral has said, so we can move this forward, and also we can go back and forth here for another half hour, and I don't think we accomplish that much. I think somebody's got to do some checking and a little research on it and have a meeting accordingly. That would be my opinion.
To be honest with you, I don't like this procedure, you know, where you get materials handed at meetings, and, you know, there's no chance for review. I have no idea, you know, really what we're looking at. And, you know, my sense is when we deal with these issues would be everyone would be much better served, particularly, you know, those who are looking for something, if we follow the procedure with, you know, materials being in on the first of the month. And so, you know, I really can't answer your question, Bill, because I really don't know what we're dealing with here. I don't have a copy of the material. I haven't had a chance to review it, so.
Are you talking about Mr. Gorham's submission this evening?
Yeah, this and the issue in general. I don't know what it encompasses and have not had a chance to discuss it with any staff.
You don't think the town planner could help out in that way, or what is needed as far as the ordinances go? I'm just trying to find a way to get it off center. To me, I think we're just jumping back and forth here and don't seem to know which way to go.
I'd rather not discuss it further.
Well, I think we know which way to go. The question is that there are options, and I think part of the problem, again, you know, this evening, Mr. Gorham had seven packets for the seven councilors. I mean, the town manager doesn't have a packet. He doesn't have the materials that we have in front of us right now, and so that puts him at a disadvantage in terms of advising us. But we do have a motion, and we do have a second. We've had considerable discussion. I think we could possibly, we are going to be proposing later on this evening a workshop for the last week of February, which we may, if it's appropriate, to get this on that workshop. It's going to be a proposed RWS workshop, but we certainly could place that there to get it moving as expeditiously as possible. I have no objection to that, but again, I would agree too, we need to move the thing on. Councilor McLaughlin.
I'm going to take this opportunity to echo the manager's comments and tell the rest of the council about my distress in what has been presented to the process in which this has been brought to us. We have a procedure. And Mr. Gorham, you may just be the victim of circumstances, so please take my comments in that light. We have a procedure that materials are submitted through the manager for the council packets. I can't respond to what I received this evening. I'm not prepared.
I'm ignorant of the procedure.
Yeah, I understand that. And we have a reason for this procedure, so that we receive things in an orderly fashion, we can evaluate the proposals that are before us and have a coherent discussion. I think that's part of our problem this evening, why we're going around and around and not getting off center, is I haven't had time to look at this. I need some time to make some intelligent decisions. I don't always think real well in my seat, as you all know. It also allows us the time to raise questions of fact. I've seen a few eyebrows go up here with some of what has been stated as your interpretation of the facts. I think you would find some differences in the interpretations of the facts from somebody else's point of view. We don't have time to respond to that, and I get really upset with the inability to respond factually, because I know what happens in other communities when information is put out as being factual. It gets printed, or people keep repeating it, and eventually it's taken for fact when indeed it is not. Last month, we had Mr. Gorham before us during the citizen discussion item on our agenda. I wasn't prepared for the material I received that evening either. That's something I think we ought to take a hard look at in the future. I was very distressed that people who serve in a volunteer position for this town were subjected to some very serious allegations, and they were not here to give any other interpretation of those allegations. So I think we have to look at our procedures, maybe reevaluate some of them, and for the good ones, keep following them. Thank you.
Well, we do have a motion. Would the town clerk refresh our memory here, since there's been considerable discussion from the original motion?
There was a motion and a second to set the accessory use only to town council workshop. From there, the town council may decide to refer this issue to the planning board and to also provide direction to the zoning board to draft an ordinance that may be referred to the planning board as well.
Okay. That is the motion. There is a second.
It's accessory apartment.
Okay, that is the motion, and we do have a second. Is there any more discussion on the part of the council? All those in favor of the motion? It is a 7-0 vote. Very fine. We will try to set that to workshop later on this evening when we talk about some other items that we'll be setting to workshop. Thank you, Mr. Gorman. Okay, let us proceed to item 123. This is to consider a request from the Republican Town Committee to appoint the Republican member and alternate to the Board of Voter Registration and take any necessary action. Would our town clerk give us an update here, please?
Thank you. You should have received in your packets a letter from Penelope G. Parson, who is the chair of the Cape Elizabeth Republican Town Committee. The nomination is for Sharon Gower to serve the three-year term as the Republican board member of the voter registration. Her term would expire on March 1st, 1995. A new law also requires that an alternate be nominated in the case that the board member would not be able to serve. The Republican committee would like to nominate Janet Love. At this time, I would recommend that you approve the two nominations.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? It is a 7-0 vote. Thank you very much. Item number 124 is to consider a proposed resolution entitled Reinvest in Hometown America and Take Any Necessary Action. I've asked the town manager to put this item on the agenda for a couple of reasons. I realize that in the past it met our agenda, and the timing just did not seem appropriate, and it was tabled. It's back here again because I think a number of events have taken place, both in the Soviet Union as well as in the United States since that time, and it is back on our agenda. I would note that there have been a variety of individuals supporting this particular issue, Reinvest in Hometown America. All of the main congressional delegation has supported this particular resolution, and we have been asked by the president of the National League of Cities, Commissioner Glenda Hood from Orlando, Florida, again to support this item in her five largest priorities. Reinvest in America is number one of the five. So, having said that, it is on the agenda. Bath Iron Works has put money where their mouth is from the point of view of, again, supporting this particular issue with Chairman Fitzgerald. Lots of people seem to be joining the bandwagon, and quite honestly, I thought it was appropriate that it come up again and that we make a statement one way or another. Any discussion or comments about this particular item?
Just a procedural question. Seeing that it was tabled, do we have to remove it from the table? Or if it was tabled indefinitely, so maybe we don't have
to. It came about a year or so ago and was worded on the agenda.
Just about this time?
No, yeah. To see if the council would consider it. And the council voted not to consider it. That was the vote.
Thank you.
So So it seemed clean this evening to just put it on without getting into needing to take it off the table. What is the will of the council on this issue? Does anyone have strong feelings one way or another?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Counselor.
As I read this and look at it, it represents bucks. Is that correct? Yes. Dollars and cents is what they want from us.
Well, no, they don't want any money from us. They want to divert money, basically.
When you say divert money,
well, we redirect federal tax dollars, yeah, basically, and you know, put them into critical domestic programs, you know, such as education, environmental protection, infrastructure, housing, health care, social services, transportation, and employment and job training, as well as to begin to reduce the federal deficit. But that would be the major intent of the, or at least one of the three major intents of the resolution.
So this is only a recommendation?
That's correct. That's correct. That's correct. My understanding is it will not cost directly Cape Elizabeth a cent. That's my understanding. Should I be corrected, Mr.
Yeah, 29 cents plus photocopies for...
I stand corrected.
Each of the members of the delegation into this project, I guess.
Might go up to $5.
Probably cost 29 cents to send Carol Day a letter to say you didn't do it.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we table this item.
Okay, we have a motion.
I'll second.
Okay, is there a discussion?
Not on a table.
Not on a table.
Okay, all those in favor? Vote is 2. All those opposed? The vote is 4. All those abstaining? 1. 2-4-1. Okay, the motion fails. I will move then the motion to consider the resolution to reinvest in hometown America. Do I have a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, there is a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Yes,
I just want to say that I did vote, I mean move to table this last year because we were just at the beginning stages of Desert Storm and it made absolutely no sense for us at that time to be recommending to Congress that they take monies from defense and reinvest it in hometown America. But seeing that reinvestment is going to take place anyway, it looks like right now, because I believe both parties are recommending that the defense budget be cut by a certain amount. I think that it would be appropriate for us as a council to say that some of that money ought to go into reducing the deficit, but some money also ought to go into the problems that we're having at the local level. So I don't see any problem with our supporting this resolution. I'm going to support it tonight.
Thank you, Councilor Emerald. Councilor Jordan.
So just a question to Councilor Emerald. So you feel with this vote that we're able to direct these funds in those directions? We're going to have nothing to say what they do with it.
No, it's
regardless.
We're just going to be part of a coalition that is asking Congress to consider redirecting those monies that are going to come, that used to be spent on defense, to redirect those funds to reducing the deficit and dealing with some of the urban and local problems that our communities are experiencing right now.
Go ahead, Phyllis.
Any other discussion on this motion? Councilor Pearson?
Yes, Chairman Kremlin. I was just going to say, this was brought up and it was very heavily publicized issue at the National League of Cities, and it gained almost unanimous support from the National League. And I think Congress took note of that at that time, as did the President, and I think specifically
just his State of the Union address as well as what you've seen in the media. The resolution, I mean, it's almost a redundant resolution because I think at this time everyone's woken up to the fact that this is going. So, A, I didn't want to table it because one way or another, go with it. I think the reason that some might be opposed to it is a redundant resolution. But I think that everyone should support it as the country, I think, is supported by it. And there's no choice but to reinvest. Where else are the money's going to go? So I'm going to support the issue as written.
Any further discussion? If it makes any difference in the vote, my understanding is that President Bush will be addressing the members of the National League of Cities on the Monday of the upcoming meeting, the congressional meetings in Washington. So he certainly is recognizing the group. Okay, seeing no further discussion, all those in favor, please signify by your right hand. It looks like 4 votes. All those opposed? 2 votes. All those abstaining? 1. Okay, the motion does carry. Thank you very much. Item number 125 is to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding leaf and brush burning and take any necessary action. I will ask the chairperson of the Ordinance Committee, Councilor Cogsall, to present this item.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A few years ago, the Ordinance Committee did revise the fire prevention group in dealing with open burning, particularly leaf and brush. But there have been continued complaints that, in particularly in heavy populated neighborhoods, that the burning seems to be overly annoying, health-threatening. And so the Ordinance Committee looked at it again. We do encourage leaf composting at the transfer station or even leaf composting in your own backyard. So under Section 8-1-4, open burning, we recommend the following change in the language. Limited leaf and brush burning by individual citizens shall not be allowed within 200 feet of a principal structure not owned by that applicant. This would still allow people who own larger tracts of land and do some leaf and brush burning in their clearing or some burning of fields for agricultural reasons to still be able to do this. It also prevents burning in the area of churches, schools, other public buildings as well.
Thank you very much, Councilor Cogsall. Any discussion on this particular item? I would entertain a motion for public hearing at this time.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we set this for public hearing at our next ordinance meeting, Monday, March 9th, 1992, at 7:30 p.m. here at the Town Hall.
Second.
A motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Vote carries 7-0. Thank you very much. Item number 126 is to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding provisions in the subdivision ordinance relating to the inspection of subdivision improvements and take any necessary action. Again, I will defer to Councilor Cogsall.
Thank you. This was recommended to the Town Council by the Planning Board. There, I guess, in the past have been some difficulties with the inspection of improvements. The amendment would be to Section 16-2-6, which would be amended to allow the construction monitor shall either be under the employ of the project design engineer or landscape architect, as stated on the approved plans, and the said design engineer or landscape architect being employed by the owner during the construction phase of the project, or an experienced construction monitor to be approved by the town manager and employed by the owner. The construction monitor shall be on site during all periods of time when significant construction is taking place. Upon completion of construction, the owner shall present to the town a set of reproducible Mylar record drawings, including facilities as constructed. The Record drawings shall be based on the field logs of the construction monitor, which is a new addition, and bear the professional seal of a design engineer, change, or a landscape architect. Then it goes on with the rest of the text. They felt that in the past there have been problems with some of the work being properly monitored by qualified people, and this would give the town an option to be able to oversee the project better. Is that true, Mr. Manager?
Yeah, that, and I think the other major point was that if during the planning process the developer or the town became very dissatisfied with the engineer working with the developer, the way the ordinance was set up, there was no way the developer could get someone else through the process. They were forced to use the same development firm until the very end of the process, and it's felt that that was anti-competitive and was not in the best interest of the developer or the community.
Any further questions?
Thank you very much, Councillor Cogswell. I would entertain a motion at this point.
I move that we set for public hearing of the changes in the Inspection of Required Improvements Ordinance. Public hearing to be held Monday, March 9th, 1992 at 7:30 p.m. at the Town Hall.
Second.
There is a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. Item 127 is to consider authorizing a quitclaim deed for map U18 lot 36 on Wheeler Road and take any necessary action. I will call upon our town clerk.
Thank you. On January 24th of this year, the town foreclosed on this piece of land for failure to pay 1990 real estate taxes. Since that time, Bank Boston has determined that they are responsible for this lot as well as the adjoining lot. They have forwarded a check to me for $252.65, which pays the taxes through the 1992 year. You should also have attached a quitclaim deed that at this time I would recommend that you authorize the town manager to sign.
Thank you very much. We have a motion.
I'll move approval.
A second?
Second.
I heard a second. Thank you very much. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Councillor McLaughlin.
Thank you. I have a question to the town clerk. This says, the memo says that the amount represents the taxes through June 30th. Does this represent fees and interest and such also?
Exactly. Okay. Plus the fee to file the quitclaim deed in the register.
To unlien it?
The discharge.
The discharge.
Okay. Yes. Thank you.
Any other questions? All those in favor? We have a 7-0 vote. Thank you very much. Okay, item number 128 is to consider designating 1226 Shore Road as the Cape Elizabeth Community Center and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Since I was very young, I've believed that you ought to put the footpaths where the people walk. You ought to respond to the way people refer things and the way people use them. 1226 Shore Road is being used as a community center. Everyone is referring to it as the community center. Therefore, I would recommend that you designate it as the Cape Elizabeth Community Center.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
I kind of missed 1226.
Councilor Amaro.
It just reminded me that the Appointments Committee held our interviews at 1226 Shore Road, soon to become the community center. And we had really very positive reaction from people as they came in, looked around, and had really complimentary things to say about the center.
Senior citizens met there as well, Deb and Sue Weatherby, and there was something Karen Allen put on from community services. They had very positive comments, although a lot of them are very concerned about sewer fees. And while I was there, I heard a lot about that, but they seemed pleased with the facility.
Councilor Cogswell.
Am I correct, Mr. McGovern, that there is not going to be a large Cape Elizabeth Community Center sign placed out front that you'll maintain, that discreet 1226 sign.
The only difference is
a residential neighborhood.
Yeah, it'll be the same sign. I'm not happy with the way that sign is angled, and during the spring we might re-angle it a little bit, but it'll be the exact same sign.
Thank you.
Any other discussion on this item? All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. Thank you again. Item number 129 this evening is to consider a report from the town manager on foreclosed property and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, the one of the councilors had asked for a report on foreclosed properties. This is what was most recently foreclosed upon. In addition, there's some that have been foreclosed upon for the last, you know, 50 years or so. I didn't give that whole list, but this is, excuse me, merely a list that are recent foreclosures. There's one here that you know, may be of concern. It's a commercial building, and you know, if the council wishes to change its policy related to how to deal with foreclosures, I would suggest that perhaps that be a workshop topic. Currently, the policy is that generally they're allowed to continue. People are allowed to continue living at foreclosed properties, you know, until such time as they want to pay the taxes, and then we do collect all past due taxes that were assessed or would have been assessed.
So the motion this evening would be acceptance of the report?
Acknowledge receipt.
Acknowledge receipt of this particular report. Councilor Jordan.
I would just like to say that maybe we should have a little workshop and update the people on just how the procedure is handled, because I think Kevin Elizabeth would do a very good job on it, and we don't publicize it like other communities do to certain people. And I would like to keep it that way, if all possible and legal or whatever. And if anybody wants to come in quietly and see it, okay, but we don't have to, I don't think, legally publicize this as a, and some of these people here and other people in the past, they've had hard times and they either come forward or they relinquish it in, you know, fair terms. So I'll move that in receipt of the list from the manager.
Okay, we have a motion of the
second.
And a second. Any discussion at this time? All those, Councilor McLaughlin.
Just a point of information that something like this becomes public information.
That's
when
right,
it's in
it
our
does.
Packets. And we don't have the authority to say that it can't be published, as far as I'm aware.
This would have already gone to the press.
You know, it's
This could have gone to the press and what have you. I agree with that 100%. And it's legally to be published and all this and stuff. But we don't have to make a big splurge about it is what I'm trying to do.
I just don't want people to feel that this is totally off bounds for the press, because it's not. And we'll
hope to
be as effective and considerate as possible with this procedure. I think a workshop would be in order for us.
Okay, any other discussion then? All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. Thank you. Item number 130 is to consider establishing a date for a town council workshop, updating the town council on regional waste systems, and take any necessary action. I also realize that we have a number of items that we may want to attempt to include in that workshop. We have the Ralph Gould Award necessary to discuss. We have a need to update council members on cable TV. We need an update on the water rate case by our town manager. Per Councilor Jordan, we can add the foreclosed property issue. And lastly, certainly the accessory apartments that we spoke about earlier tonight. How many or how few of those six items we could include? I'd like to try to include them all, since they're all on the burner, so to speak. And we can try to look at our calendars. I was going to propose Tuesday, February 25th as a possible workshop, at least to start with that. And
move to other days if that wasn't workable.
Mr. Chairman, are we going to do this in public session?
Well, we typically don't. That's a good point. Maybe we can do this, we can...
I think we can do this out of public focus.
That's fine.
And the date will be announced.
We'll announce the date publicly.
The public doesn't have to suffer through these seven counselors and their calendars.
If anyone wants to know the date, they can call tomorrow.
No, it's not a nice process.
Okay. So at this particular time, then, we will... Who would like to move on item 130?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we enter executive session to conduct the town manager's annual evaluation.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion to second. Any discussion?
We skipped something.
Yeah, we do have item 131. We've got to really finish up 130. Since we started it.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we establish our workshop date out of public session.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion to second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Okay, that is a 7-0 vote. Now I'll be happy to proceed to citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda at this particular time. Is there anyone that would like to address the council? Seeing no one jump, I'll end that portion of the agenda and move to item number 131. This is to consider entering into executive session to conduct the town manager's annual evaluation and take any necessary action. And I also will add to receive an update with respect to opening negotiations with the police department. Those will be the two items discussed in executive session. Could I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? It is unanimous, 7-0.
It was the police association.
It was the police association. Did I say the police department?
Yeah.
The police association, excuse me.
Unless other rumors that.
Okay. At this time, we will, I'll take a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Can we adjourn? I'm not sure we can adjourn.
Well, we're moving to executive session.
That's fine. No business will be.
Right. So the public will know we'll do no more business. But
that's correct. Well, we will have to come out of executive session to adjourn.
Yes.
So at this time, we will say goodnight and we'll be moving into executive session. But we do need to vote on that, don't we? All those in favor? On executive session. Okay. 7-0. Thank you very much. And thank you all this evening for watching. Good night. It might be a record.
Yes, you do. Yes. Good at field hockey.